Okay, so music and autism is a really interesting subject, at least in my view, because a lot of the things that we look at in autism are very much to do with the social communication disability and the other kinds of things that we see, like obsessions and rigidity, sensory problems. So looking at music in autism is a way of really getting a much fuller picture of the way that these people function and how they develop over time. It is, I believe it's very important because it gives us kind of an understanding of the sort of emotional and aesthetic qualities that people with autism have. And these are not really very often looked at in this kind of way. If we think historically, autism was first described in 1946 by Leo Kanner. And of course, Kanner laid down the basic principles of the diagnostic criteria in autism. But one of the things that people have not really taken on board was that he did talk about exceptional musical skills in these children, particularly their ability to remember extremely complicated music. And I think subsequently we began to think this was really interesting when we think about it in the context of problems with language and other aspects of cognition. So I think another thing to note that's quite important too is that we've seen a massive change in the prevalence of autism over the last 10 years, 10, 20 years. So we have many more people now with a diagnosis of autism who are intellectually very high functioning. So increasingly, we're seeing more and more people who are actually professional musicians, who are performing music at an extremely high level, who do have a diagnosis of autism. The work that I was most interested in was initially looking at tonal and rhythmic perception in music in autism, and the impetus for this was really drawn from musical savants. So musical savants are individuals who have extraordinary musical ability, but often have quite severe impairments in intellectual and language abilities. And we saw in musical savants that they have unbelievable tonal skills. So they have extremely good pitch processing, very extraordinary memory for music, and also skills that are a bit more unusual and unexpected. So, for example, we see some composing, we see lots of improvisation, which gives evidence of kind of flexibility and creativity that we wouldn't predict that we would find in this group. So my original studies that I did in the late 90s were really aiming at looking at tonality, rhythmic ability, tonality more specifically, within groups of children with autism that we wouldn't consider to be savants. These children have not had lots of musical training. They weren't showing exceptional musical skills in a kind of accepted sense. But when we carried out empirical studies with these children, we found that they had extreme sensitivity to musical pitch. And then we began to think about these abilities in terms of theoretical accounts of autism. So particularly, I was interested in the weak central coherence theory, which at that time predicted that children with autism would indeed be very sensitive to local aspects of stimuli, and this was borne out by them having exceptional pitch. But this theory also predicted impairments in global information processing. And when we came to look at music perception in autism, we found that they didn't have any global impairments. We found that they were processing melodic information and other kinds of very global aspects of music in an extremely normal way. After that, I became very interested in the idea of the emotion recognition impairments in autism. So the empirical literature very much shows that people with autism are much less proficient than typically developing people at recognizing emotions on faces and emotions on voices. So we then looked at whether or not they would be able to recognise emotions in music. And what we found was that they were recognising emotions in music just as well as typically developing children. And then eventually we began to think about investigating this in different kinds of ways. So we looked at whether or not we're seeing heightened emotional responses and whether or not we're seeing similar patterns of brain behaviour in response to music in individuals with autism. And of course, these studies have been carried out in many labs around the country, especially in Canada. Researchers there have done a lot of this work. And it just seems to be the case at the moment that people with autism are very sensitive to emotions in music. And it looks as though the brain is processing musical information in really very similar way. I think we're getting evidence now coming in showing that therapeutic interventions using music are highly effective with people with ASD. So we're seeing a range of different kinds of therapeutic approaches that are targeting interaction behaviours, language behaviours, emotional understanding, and they all seem to be yielding very positive results. So I would say that these initial studies looking at musical building blocks, tonality, etc., have developed into a programme of research that's shown a very surprising sparing of musical abilities in this disorder. The question that I'm the most interested in is, we know that people with autism are very good at recognising anger in music, but much less good at recognising anger on faces and in voices. And what's more, they find it difficult to recognise anger in themselves. So even though they're very aware that they're emotionally very aroused, and they might be able to say, well, you know, I was insulted, or I saw someone behaving badly, they won't be able to link that directly to the emotion of anger. This is a disorder called alexithymia that is very, very common in autism. And we've done some work trying to look at whether or not we can capitalise on autistic people's ability to understand emotions in music, to educate themselves about these emotions so that they can then understand them in other contexts. For example, in the context of their own emotional states and the emotional states of other people. I think one of the things that we need to be very clear about is that autism is exceptionally heterogeneous as a disorder. So we see people with autism that are professors of mathematics in prestigious universities, all the way through to people who have no language and, you know, function intellectually at quite low levels. So we have to be fairly wary of making generalisations. But based on the research evidence, which admittedly has mostly been carried out with more able individuals with autism, we believe that they listen to music in ways that are very typical. So for example, we've done qualitative research asking people with autism why they listen to music, what is it about music that makes it attractive to them? And we find out kind of responses we get from them are so similar to those that we get from neurotypical people. So I think I would probably say that listening experiences are very variable in autism, but we can't say that they are different to neurotypical people in one very simple way.